Good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting in 2021 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. We have received apologies today from Liz Smith. Tess White is attending as a substitute from the Conservatives. I welcome her to the meeting, and as this is the first time Tess has joined us, I invite her to declare any relevant interests.
I have no interest to declare.
Thank you. We now turn to agenda item two, which is to take evidence on the National Performance Framework. We are joined for this session by John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery. And of course, John is no stranger, having attended myriad meetings of the predecessor committees over many years. He's accompanied by his officials, Barry Stalker, Head of National Performance Framework Unit, and Tim Ellis, Deputy Director for Performance and Outcomes Division. I welcome our witnesses to the meeting. Members have received a briefing paper from clerks, and I intend to allow up to 90 minutes for this session. But before we move to questions from the committee, I invite Mr. Swinney to make a short opening statement, should he wish to do so.
Thank you, Convener, and I welcome the opportunity to appear before the committee today. The National Performance Framework is Scotland's wellbeing framework. It explicitly includes increased wellbeing as part of its purpose and combines measurement of how well Scotland is doing in economic terms with a broader range of measures. The National Performance Framework is also the means to localise delivery of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals in Scotland. The NPF provides a framework for collaboration and for planning of policy and services across the whole spectrum of Scotland's civic society, including private and public sectors, voluntary organisations, businesses and communities. It is based on achieving outcomes that improve the quality of life of the people of Scotland. The NPF is also a reporting framework that helps us understand, publicly and transparently, the progress we are making as a nation towards realising our long-term vision. Its data helps us understand the challenges we all face in achieving better outcomes for the people of Scotland and to focus policy services and resources on tackling these challenges. The NPF promotes partnership working by making organisations jointly responsible for planning and spending to achieve shared outcomes. While Scottish Ministers are accountable to the Parliament for the NPF's development and delivery, the Community Empowerment Act places a duty on public authorities to have regard to the national outcomes. Reflecting this partnership approach, the current NPF was launched jointly by the Scottish Government and the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, and local government plays a key role in achieving the national outcomes. With my remit for COVID recovery, I'm keen to see the NPF continue to guide our approach to recovery. During the early stages of the pandemic, the Scottish Government's approach looked to the National Performance Framework. The Coronavirus Framework for Decision-Making explicitly reflected the core values of the National Performance Framework: kindness, dignity, compassion, respect for the rule of law, openness and transparency. Analysis has shown that the pandemic has had significant and wide-ranging impact across the national outcomes. As would be expected, these are largely negative, particularly in terms of health, economy, fair work and business and culture. COVID-19 impacts have been and will continue to be borne unequally. These impacts are expected to widen many existing inequalities and be borne disproportionately among some groups, including households on low income or in poverty, low-paid workers, children and young people, older people, disabled people, minority groups and women. However, analysis also shows that there may also be positive future developments, including the acceleration of the shift towards digital technologies and services, for example, partnership working between the public sector and other partners to improve outcomes for disadvantaged groups, and potential shifts in the empowerment of communities to make decisions for themselves. Understanding these impacts will be important drivers for recovery and for achieving the national outcomes as reflected in our recent programme for government. We are preparing now for the next statutory review of the national outcomes, which we will consult widely on across Scotland, including with Parliament. Following the outcome of the 2018 review, when the NPF received cross-party support, we will revisit the roundtable approach to further political engagement on Scotland's future wellbeing, building on the shared policy agreement that the Government has reached with the Scottish Green Party. The review will focus on how we can better achieve impact that is recognised and felt by the people living in Scotland. We strongly believe in our duty as a government to protect the interests of future generations, including by restoring the natural environment and reducing our consumption in line with what the planet can sustain. This duty to future generations is spread across many policies and institutions. The National Performance Framework provides intergenerational well-being and improving opportunities for all, and means attending to the conditions that are required to ensure well-being into the future and for future generations, and not only for the present.
Thank you very much for that opening statement. In a time-honoured fashion, I will ask some opening questions, and then members of the committee will join in with their questions. In your statement this morning, Deputy First Minister, you said that outcome budgeting is about allocating resources based on the outcomes achieved for people. And I'm just wondering whether the National Performance Framework has helped to deliver that, and if so, if you can give us a couple of examples.
There's always a challenge in any budgeting process, and your words are welcome this morning, Convener. You made reference to the fact that I have been a regular attender at this committee over many years and have great familiarity with the budget process. There is always a challenge in ensuring that budget priorities can be realigned to meet changing trends and demands within society, and particularly to achieve different outcomes. And one of the important points of consideration that has gone into budgeting, in certainly in my view since 2007, and which is reflected in the National Performance Framework, helps us in this respect, is in undertaking budgeting decisions that help us to align more closely with the achievement of national outcomes. So one example I would cite in that respect would be investment in early learning and childcare, where there is quite clearly a new amount of money got to be found to ensure that we can have 1,140 hours of early learning and childcare for 3- and 4-year-olds and for eligible 2-year-olds. And that clearly supports national outcomes, where we are trying to intervene at the earliest stage to provide the strongest foundations for children to achieve their potential, as is referenced in the in one of the national outcomes. We grow up loved, safe and respected so we can realise our full potential. But that involves financial decisions that have got to be taken at an operational budget level to ensure that we can support such objectives. So I think the National Performance Framework provides us with a sense of long-term policy direction, of outcomes that we are aiming to achieve, that in many respects, if you take the early learning and childcare example, cannot be achieved without the willing and active participation of local government, which of course we have been able to rely upon in taking forward that policy objective. And it enables us to take short-term decisions that support the achievement of a long-term outcome, which is the purpose and the influence of the National Performance Framework.
Okay, thank you. Now, in 2018, after the last review, all the time purpose targets were removed as continuous improvement is the goal. And if we actually look at the indicators, we can see exactly why that is the case. But do all 81 indicators have milestones to help track improvements?
That will vary from area to area. In some circumstances, yes, that will be the case. Again, going back to the early learning and childcare example, there would be indicators in place that would set a timescale for the implementation of such a policy and, as a consequence, determine the timescale within which decisions were required and practical actions needing to be taken. In other areas, there will be other areas of policy, for example, on eradicating child poverty, where there will be particular target dates that we are aiming to achieve and plans put in place to try to achieve those objectives. That will throw up challenges for government and for public authorities, because the timescales may well be more demanding than we can achieve, but the availability of milestones to structure the way in which decision-making requires to be taken will be present where that can be of assistance in achieving those outcomes.
Okay, thank you. Now, if we look at the 81 indicators, we see that in 17 the performance is improving, in 42 performance is maintaining, and in 11 performance is worsening, while there are 4 where performance is to be confirmed and indicators are in development. And we appreciate that this is an evolving situation. And if we look at some of those that are worsening, some seem fairly obvious in relation to COVID, places to interact, for example, social capital, economic growth. But in others, it's hard to see why there would be a worsening of performances. So, for example, if we look at the Fair Work and Business section, we see that the number of high-growth businesses and innovative businesses are declining, and also the employee voice. I mean, it should be said that economic participation, employees receiving a living wage and pay gap and gender balance has improved. So four of those indicators in that section have improved, but three have actually worsened. So why actually is it that those are worsening, and what is the Scottish Government doing to respond to those indicators?
Essentially, on the issues around high-growth businesses and innovative businesses, my assessment of that would be a combination of two factors. One is a historical trend where this area of economic activity has been historically a challenge for Scotland for many, many years. Although I think in the period in the aftermath of the financial crash, there were significant enhancements in the development of high growth businesses, and indeed the government put in place a range of different interventions to support the development of high growth businesses. Particularly, I'm thinking about the Scottish Edge, which was a collaboration with the Hunter Foundation and other stakeholders, the support for women into enterprise, the Converse Challenge within the higher education sector to encourage the rollout of a greater number of high growth companies emerging out of the higher education sector. So a number of different interventions are put in place to try to address areas where there is a poorer performance. I think the indicator on employee voice is slightly more difficult to... So that's the first of those issues in relation to the high-growth businesses. The second is obviously the effect of the more general economic conditions in which we've been operating as a consequence of COVID, which is referenced or evidenced by the situation in relation to economic growth. So I think there's that combination of the historic and the very much real-time issues that we face. The issue on employee voice is slightly more difficult to nail down because all of the policy interventions that we will take as a government are all designed to support the acceleration and intensification of employee contribution towards the operation of organisations and businesses, which I would argue is, from a business perspective, a very sound investment to take forward because of the added value that can be attracted by capturing the input and the contribution of employees in the running and the development of organisations. Now, that indicator will be informed substantially by survey evidence from employees. And obviously, if that's reflected that lack of input is reflected in that survey evidence, then clearly the government's Fair Work agenda has to be intensified, and we will take that forward by the dialogue we take forward with a range of organisations such as the Business Representative Organisations and the Scottish Trade Union Congress, with whom we collaborate closely on all aspects of the Fair Work agenda.
Okay, thank you for that. And just one final question for me, as colleagues are keen to come in. Obviously, we have the 81 indicators and 11 national outcomes, and they are exactly that, national outcomes. And when we look at the improvements, which indicators are worsening and which are maintaining, we're looking at a national picture here. So how do we assess what is happening in different parts of Scotland through the National Performance Framework? Because clearly within some areas where performance is maintaining, there may be some areas where the situation is improving quite consistently and others where it's deteriorating. And the idea is that if we just have an indicator that says maintaining, it could mask quite a huge differential across the country. Now, obviously, we can't have a situation where we've got thousands of different indicators. That would be ridiculous. But how does the government actually look beyond the kind of figures of worsening, improving or maintaining to actually find out what is actually within the body of the kirk, so to speak?
On all of these different indicators, ministers and officials will be heavily engaged in assessing performance and patterns across the country. So if I go back to the world that I used to occupy in the last Parliament of education policy, I was looking at all times at differential performance around the country, and it was the subject of some frequently pretty robust discussion between myself and individual local authorities about performance in relation to educational attainment, for example, and the progress that I expected to see there. So I wouldn't want the committee to consider that this is the only stock take or the only discussion of performance. There will be a lot of discussion that goes on in and around the territory of the National Performance Framework to make sure that we are doing all that we can to intervene to improve performance. Now, some of that performance, and this is where the National Performance Framework is designed to be a helpful and useful guide to all public bodies, private organisations, about what is the direction in which government policy, supported by decisions made in Parliament, is heading, and what can organisations contribute towards the achievement of that vision. Obviously, there will be a number of issues that are properly, statutorily, the responsibility of other public bodies and particularly local authorities. So local decision making is crucial in this respect. But we won't get to a strong position on performance at a national level if we don't, in terms of your question, convener, get to a strong position of local performance. So there has to be an interaction and a dialogue there. Now, there are obviously political choices to be arrived at here. There can be more directional decision making taken forward. Parliament has particular views about that. Sometimes it's in favour of it, sometimes it's not. But what ministers have to do in the current environment is operate within the statutory framework. And the National Performance Framework, which is endorsed by our local authority partners, is designed to give a clear and coherent approach to the delivery of policy, to shape the decision-making that can be taken forward at local level to then influence the contribution that is made in terms of achievement of the national outcomes.
OK, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues, and the first questioner will be Deputy Convener Daniel, to be followed by Michelle.
Thank you very much, Convener. I would say whenever I've looked at the National Performance Framework, I've been struck that it has a sort of strong influence, or it seems to me, of kind of the balanced scorecard approach, which you see kind of in a lot of modern management thinking. And sort of looking at kind of the Kaplan and Norton paper back from the early 90s, which instituted that, they highlight the fact that balanced scorecard technique should highlight on four areas. One is customer perspective, internal perspective, looking at what the organisation excels at. One is about innovation and learning, and finally, shareholder return. Now, not all of those obviously apply to government, but there are analogues such as citizens' perspective, and that last one, I think, essentially about how we generate revenue or economic perspective. The other critical thing that they do is say that those measures have to be explicitly linked to goals. And so my question is this. When I look at the National Performance Framework, it seems very, very broad. It doesn't appear to me to have that level of focus, or certainly when you look into the National Performance Goals, those perspectives aren't necessarily preserved down into that level. And I'm just wondering whether or not, on reflection, as we look to improve the National Performance Framework, greater focus so that those measures can actually drive strategy rather than just being a broad basket of measures, would be of some advantage.
I think there's undoubtedly a debate to be had there on this question, because what I've set out in my opening statement and in my responses to the conveners so far is that the National Performance Framework is designed to give a clarity of purpose and direction to the country, to which all relevant organisations, and I use that word in that term in its broadest sense, can look and to say, well, you know, how is this relevant to us, and what can we contribute towards this journey that the country is on? Now, so that's one purpose. Another purpose is to discipline us, I suppose, to make tangible progress in achieving these objectives over time. And that's where I think the issues that Mr. Johnson raises, I think, are very relevant, because there could be greater signposting put into this exercise. There could be more definitive targets about what could or should be achieved over a given period of time. It's a perfectly legitimate debate to be had. I think what that then would have to be understood to be would be an approach that would require probably much greater policy direction as to what was expected to be happening as a consequence. So there's undoubtedly a debate to be had there, and obviously the review that we undertake in 2023 will provide us with the opportunity to reflect on what's been, I think, a genuine approach that was taken in 2018, a genuine approach to engage with a variety of different interested parties, not least of which Parliament, and to design a framework that actually is relevant and effective for policy making in Scotland.
Thank you for that answer, and I don't disagree with it, and I have to sort of emphasise, I mean, I think that ultimately the National Performance Framework is a useful thing. I guess what I'm saying is I wonder if it could be made more useful. And just to the points you were just raising, I mean, is there not an alternative approach? It's not necessarily purely about setting targets, but there is perhaps emphasis that could be applied to certain measures. If you look at balanced scorecards in particular, that's explicitly what you do. You attach weightings to particular measures. Is that potentially an approach that could be taken to sort of strengthen the strategic value of the measurements that are included within the framework?
Undoubtedly, decisions could be taken to essentially tilt the balance of this, to place more emphasis, you know, for argument's sake, on you know, that we live in communities that are inclusive, empowered, resilient and safe, as opposed to we are creative and vibrant and have diverse cultures and are expressed and enjoyed widely. You know, so we could say, well, actually, we think there's much more importance in ensuring that we have greater progress on community empowerment than we do about cultural appreciation. I just randomly extract those two topics. But, of course, there is the shape for the scope for that balance to be tilted. And, obviously, we would have to be aware that of what the implications of that might well be, because what we are trying to achieve here is an approach which enables us to fulfil the purpose of policy making within Scotland, but there is undoubtedly the scope for us to reshape the balance of that to address other and particular priorities.
Mm-hmm. So, again, one of my worries with the National Performance Framework is that it's very broad, both in terms of the way the objectives are framed and then the number of measures which sit below. And I wonder if there's almost a missing layer. So, for example, if you were looking at children and young people, the national outcome is we grow up loved, safe, respected, and so that we realise our full potential. I don't think anyone anywhere would disagree with that as an objective. And then when you go through the national framework, you immediately then descend into actually quite detailed, you know, statistics. And I wonder if there is an intermediary layer that is required, looking at, well, actually, you know, this is how that overall objective will be achieved. These are the measures which drive it, because ultimately, I think you have to discriminate between different measures, because some measures will essentially be input measures, others will be output measures. You know, some measures will trail, and others will be early indicators. And I think without that, that sort of strategic emphasis of what's more important, and also differentiating between different types of measures, you've just got a sea of data, and it doesn't actually drive change or orient behaviour across government.
I think it's a really good example to focus on, because when you when you come down from the national outcomes, believe you me, there is no shortage of data beneath the aspiration of children growing up loved, safe and respected. There's no absence of data. And indeed, that's highlighted in the national indicators. And indeed, the national indicators are only a snapshot of the data that's actually available. What is required is for, I think, certainly as somebody who's immersed in that area of policy for 5 years, I would be looking at a whole range of data sets to establish trends of whether we were heading in a positive direction or a negative direction as a consequence of the experience of children and young people in our society, and was intervening at an operational level to remedy instances where I thought there was a need for us to have stronger performance. So when, for example, we look at an indicator like quality of children's services, that's an area I would be looking at very, very, very closely, looking at data identified by Care Inspectorate, Audit Scotland, by the data that would emerge out of some of the wider collection of data about child protection, child wellbeing issues, to determine, and to go back to the convener's point, the degree to which I needed to have more of a focus on area A versus area B within the country, where there might be very different patterns emerging. And what was driving, for example, good performance in area B versus poorer performance in area A, and what we needed to do as a government to enable us to be confident that we were doing all that we could to ensure that children were growing up loved, safe and respected, to intervene to secure that better performance where it was required to be achieved. So I think the question which I think Mr. Johnson fairly puts to me is, can that be more visibly set out in the National Performance Framework as somewhere in the gap between we grow up loved, safe and respected and we have half a dozen indicators here? I think there's a reasonable point to be considered there as to whether or not all of the information that we promote to reflect the achievement of those outcomes is in fact the most effective collection of data, because there's a whole host of data we could select from to enable that to be the case.
So this is my final question. Just my reflection on what you've just said, Deputy First Minister, is actually, in a sense, it's about making explicit what you've just said about the way you actually use the data, and I think that actually might be helpful. So this is my last question. I think we all recognise these are important measures. I just wonder whether or not there's a need to report against them more explicitly. I mean, I can't recall the last time a minister actually made a statement explicitly about the National Performance Framework, and particularly rather than about it as a tool, but actually about its outcomes and what it was saying in their portfolio. Do you think there's a need to have more explicit reporting by ministers against the measures in the National Performance Framework?
Yes, I was at the heart of the creation of the National Performance Framework back in 2007. And I convened some discussions with representatives of all parties to consider how best we should develop some of this thinking, and then responsibility passed on to my successors. But I think at different times we considered whether or not there was the need for an annual statement on progress in the National Performance Framework to Parliament. I think that must have been an issue that was considered around about some of the issues around statute. Now, it doesn't need statute to require us to do that. Could do that, choose that any day of the week. So if there was an aspiration to do that, the committee felt that was something that would be beneficial as it reflects on these issues. The government would be very happy to consider that.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, to be followed by Tess.
Thank you. Good morning, Deputy First Minister. Perhaps following on from the point that Daniel's been making, I found it, you know, when I went through it, and like you, I think we've all been aware of the history and development of the NPF, and I accord value in of it itself whilst understanding how it started. But when I looked at it, I found it incredibly difficult to derive any meaning from the performance maintaining or worsening. And if I was reading anything, the first thing I'd be looking for is an outline of the methodology. Now, you might not want to give every sort of data set, the multitude of data sets away, but I had no sense of how you arrived at that. And therefore, from an academic perspective, if I read anything that I have no sense of the methodology, I'm inclined to ask the question, how do I know it's true? So in that respect, would you, and it sort of follows on from what Daniel said, would you, as part of that consideration of its development, be prepared to set out some indication of methodology as an aid to arriving at?
Well, I think I think the National Performance Framework is a proposition that, frankly, the more you delve, the more you discover. So it's one of those. So it's all there. Is essentially the point that I'm making, that we have set out the rationale for in the detailed documents about why we've arrived at this particular selection of data sets or information to inform and to determine progress. Now that is an approach which can stand up to scrutiny, but obviously people are free to say, well, actually, I don't think you've arrived at the right half a dozen indicators which support a proposition on tackling poverty. We don't think you're looking at the right things. Now, of course, there's obviously scope for that debate to be had, but the rationale as to how we've arrived at that selection of information is all there. But it's subject to challenge and debate, and obviously the review that we go into in 2023 gives us the opportunity to have that discussion.
And following on from that, given the undoubted complexities introduced by COVID, Brexit, and the really challenging themes around net zero, just transition, human rights and equalities is another, well-being, of course, what plans are you able to outline today, if any, as to your thinking of how you might develop the NPF?
I think I would differentiate in some of the issues that Michelle Thompson has raised with me there about what would drive changes in the National Performance Framework. I don't think, if we take, for example, COVID, I don't think COVID should be a particular driver of change in the composition of the National Performance Framework, because it's something that's happened to us, it challenges us, but in terms of what the National Performance Framework is seeking to encourage government and other bodies to do, COVID is just another issue to wrestle with in trying to address that agenda. Net zero, however, might be an issue that forces a substantive reconsideration of the National Performance Framework, because that is a strategic policy direction, policy imperative, which may actually, to go back to the points that Daniel Johnson was raising with me, may require us to reshape the balance of the National Performance Framework to say, well, because of the requirement to achieve net zero, we have to change the balance of the National Performance Framework to make that realisable. So yes, there is the scope to do that. That's what the purpose of the five-year review is designed to do. But it would be, I think, more about those aspirational elements of policy direction rather than addressing the consequences of an issue like COVID or Brexit has forced upon us.
Mm-hmm. Okay, again, following on from that, it's almost like evaluating where we are at the moment. There's been lots of debate from the original starting point, which you recall, in terms of determining value add of public spend, arriving at therefore the National Performance Framework. And again, I appreciate the complexity, but do you see a further drift towards making that linkage again in terms of public spend to outcomes, or do you largely conclude at the moment that is incredibly complex, a view I have a lot of sympathy with, and that we will carry on as we are with a very broad framework, again going back to a point that Daniel made?
That link between public spend and outcomes is complex, but it is critical that it is properly understood. So the National Performance Framework helps us in that endeavour, but there'll be other things that help us in that endeavour. The process of audit and evaluation, and particularly policy audit evaluation, is critical in that journey. There will be other interventions. If we look at, for example, the independent care review, which took about 3 years to look at its evidence base, and I summarise thousands and thousands of hours worth of analysis and research in the next couple of sentences. I don't do that to be in any way disrespectful, but we have got a limited time. But it essentially said the money isn't spent very well on delivering good outcomes for care experienced young people. So therefore you should reshape that, which is what we are now doing, and which we set out by our acceptance of the promise report and by the steps that have been taken in the programme for government, which is a very good example of exactly the point that Michelle Thompson puts to me, which is you're spending your money in one way, but it's not delivering good outcomes, so you need to think about shifting how you spend your money, which is what we're now doing on that issue. And there are other examples I could cite in the field of youth justice. Over the course of about 10 years, we have substantively realigned the way in which we spend our resources to deliver better outcomes. So we have many fewer young people having their life chances influenced by and affected by and undermined by interactions with the criminal justice system, by having diversionary routes available to those young people to enable them to achieve better outcomes when they have faced difficulty in their lives. But that involved realignment of spend from how we were doing it before to how we're doing it now. So there has to be a willing openness to look at some of these questions and to be prepared to spend money differently, however complex deciding on those priorities and those challenges might actually be.
Okay, last wee question, convener. In terms of the Just Transition Committee, has made the statement about moving beyond GDP as the only measure of Scotland's progress. And I know we've all wrestled with GDP being a crude measure, but an internationally recognised one. I'm just wondering about your thinking about how you might be able to do that and how that would play into other agencies such as the Scottish Fiscal Commission. A question I asked on this committee was how they were fairly reflecting the risks of climate change in doing their forward forecast. And again, I appreciate this is very complex, but I'd appreciate your latest thinking on that complexity, particularly in regard to GDP and other measures.
What the National Performance Framework tries to do is to put a concept such as GDP, which is important, into a proper and full context. And so the National Performance Framework is trying to set out what factors we need to think of as a society, as a country, one of which will be GDP, and there will be a whole range of others, but it's to try to put that in a proper context so that we don't, you know, Daniel Johnson raised the question with me of balanced scorecard. It's about trying to have a framework that enables people to judge, enables parliamentarians to judge where should the balance of our policy making be when we see a whole range of different patterns of development in particular policy areas. How can we take decisions which better reflect a more rounded approach to policy making than just saying the one indicator I'm going to look at is GDP and to the expense of everything else. And that's quite clearly the antithesis of the National Performance Framework. And the NPF is our attempt to try to put concepts such as GDP into the proper context.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Tested followed by Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, I've got three questions, one about simplification, one about accountability, and one about the impact of COVID-19. So the first question, so Ray Perman, who was representing the Royal Society of Edinburgh, told the committee last week when he was here that he was amazed by how many targets and desired outcomes there were in the performance framework and that it could be simplified. So that was his view. And he drew a parallel with the 17 UN Sustainable Development Goals, which he suggested were more straightforward. Do you share Mr. Perman's view that the framework could be simplified?
It undoubtedly could be, yes. And I think the judgment that Parliament would have to come to a view about is whether in so doing it was losing any of the rounded nature of the National Performance Framework. Because there will be, and there are fine judgments to be arrived at here, and I don't try to suggest there's a perfect science here, that there will be some citizens will attach greater priority to the country being putting more emphasis on this area of policy than that area of policy, that want to see this area of policy more predominant in shaping the future of our country than that area of policy. So these are all subjective considerations. I think it's a possibility that we might lose some of that rounded nature if we were to simplify. But equally, there is an upside that it might provide greater scope for sharper choices to be made about where we should place our emphasis and our interventions if we were to follow the route that's been put to me.
So you are open to looking at it again? And
very happy to do so.
Okay, great, thank you. The second question is relates to accountability. So Professor Reiner, Associate Professor in Public Policy at the LSE, commented that the performance outcomes are typically long-term, and you did actually mention that yourself, and they're affected by a variety of factors, which often makes it very difficult, sometimes nigh on impossible, to attribute responsibility to specific government interventions. So how do we know with certainty what's working and what isn't?
That's a really fascinating and significant question, because I think the purpose, I think there are different factors at play here. I think the National Performance Framework is one example of accountability in our country, but it's not the only one. There's loads of other ones as well. So I mentioned audit, for example. I mentioned parliamentary accountability. There's statutory reporting there's a whole variety of different other ways where we can see very directly what is the consequence of an intervention on an item of expenditure on a particular outcome. Now, that will be demonstrable in some aspects of the National Performance Framework. It will be demonstrable in various other settings in which that issue is tested. So I think that there has to be, I think, an acknowledgement and an acceptance that the National Performance Framework will tell us so much about the development of policy within Scotland, but there will be a whole variety of other areas where that can be looked at as well. So if I give another example, we could go and look at the Audit Scotland Annual Review of the National Health Service, for example. Now, that feels to me to be quite a sharp piece of accountability in relation to a number of areas of policy, whereas the National Performance Framework is trying to structure how do we take forward a journey which, on all of these questions, will inevitably be a long-term journey. You know, we tackle poverty. Well, we won't tackle poverty in a year. Poverty will take us, you know, there'll be a longer period required to do that. So what we're trying to avoid is, or what we're trying to encourage, is the focus on long-term, coherent areas of policy without in any way losing the sharpness of our day-to-day interventions contributing towards that journey, or are they not? Now, to go back to the example I cited to Michelle Thompson, on the position of care experience young people, we've had a piece of research which says to us that the current method of expenditure is not supporting good outcomes for those young people. We want to support better outcomes for those young people, so the conclusion the government has arrived at is we better change the way in which we spend the money. So there's a very concrete example of how you have to change course because you're not delivering a satisfactory outcome. And I think that's an example of effective accountability.
So in summary, you're saying it's a direction of travel, but there are other measures like Audit Scotland that actually test whether or not you're hitting those milestones. Thank you. And then the final question is around the identification of continuous improvement in that direction of travel. But COVID-19, as we know, has prevented the collection and reporting of data. So you talk about young people. For example, the educational attainment indicator states that data could not be collected from some of the sub-measures for 2019 and 20 because of school closures during this pandemic, meaning that a quote-unquote performance is to be confirmed. So how would you see a reconciliation of performance to be confirmed with milestone measurement?
I think the example that Tess White cites is a very vivid example of this, because essentially we have a continuous data set up until 2019, and then we have two data sets for on exam results, for example, on 2020 and 2021 that are constructed in a fundamentally different fashion. So that's quite a challenge to reconcile one methodology for umpteen years to then a different methodology for 2 years. So that obviously there then has to be, I think, some open dialogue about the analysis of that information to make sure that we can have a proper understanding of whether or not we're making progress towards the long-term objectives, or whether we've in fact had a setback as a consequence of COVID. And I think that requires, one data set is not going to do that. That's going to take a rounded piece of work. That's what the Education Recovery Group looks at, as to what is all of this information in the round telling us about where young people are and their achievements, given the fact that the data sets we would normally rely upon have been interrupted by COVID. And there's no easy answer to that, but I think some considered research that we can discuss and debate, that committees of Parliament can analyse and air, is quite an effective way of doing that.
Thank you. It's my questions, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Douglas, to be followed by John.
Thank you, Convener. Deputy First Minister, in 2018, Derek Mackay said that a small number of the indicators were yet to be developed. Just now, we still have 11 indicators still to be developed, or no or limited data, which is about 13%. When could we expect to see those indicators being put in place?
Obviously, the work to enable that to be the case is, you know, an early priority. Obviously, a lot of stuff has been interrupted, so just rehearsed with Tess White as a consequence of COVID, and some of the, although there's a lot of data around in government, perhaps not all the data sets that enable us to get a complete picture are available, so we have to construct new data sets, and obviously that takes time. Some of that has been interrupted by COVID, but I'm certainly happy to write to the committee about where we might see particular points being achieved in terms of the collection of that data.
Okay, that would be helpful. And following on from that, you know, four of the missing indicators are in education. I've heard that, you know, the government's top priority was education. So why have these indicators not been prioritised?
Well, for many of the reasons that I've just cited, that we've had the interruption of COVID.
Mm-hmm. But I guess that would interrupt the data that we have. But according to the report, the indicators are still in development.
No, but that's my point. That in many respects, these will be new data sets that we're trying to create. So we have been severely restricted in the collection of data during COVID for obvious reasons. That, you know, when I was pressing the education system for information about participation and engagement and attendance, there was a fair amount of resistance from quite a number of public authorities, not least of which local authorities, about the data demands I was placing on them. But I wanted to be satisfied that online learning was happening, that there was adequate engagement, and I can only collect that from local authorities. So you sometimes have to structure a balance about what you can reasonably and legitimately demand at any one time when there's a pandemic on.
Mm-hmm. So you're confident that, you know, the indicators will be ready fairly soon.
So we'll give. I'm happy to give the committee an update on where we are there.
Okay, thank you. I think it's been mentioned already that we see performance worsening indicators around work and business, especially around economic growth, which we heard last week at committee was obviously key for us as a nation. So, does this concern you? Because the lack of economic growth, surely that will have an impact on many of the other indicators, I'm thinking around poverty, as we go forward.
I obviously want to see improvements in economic performance and in economic growth. I think it is vital for us as a society, but there's of course a multitude of factors that are affecting economic performance. We are seeing the effects vividly just now of Brexit. In relation to economic activity. We are seeing the impact of COVID on the economy. Now, obviously, we've growth figures that show an improving recovery from the downturn that's taken place as a consequence of the pandemic, and that's welcome. But obviously, the government is focusing on a range of different interventions to ensure that we improve that performance. Part of my thinking around the COVID recovery strategy is the importance of tackling the financial security of families. Financial security of families is absolutely critical to eradicating child poverty. But to enable financial security of families to be strengthened, we have to have better paying employment opportunities within our society. So stimulating that higher quality economic environment is really crucial.
But as a committee, should we expect some of these indicators to show a worsening position because of the economic situation that we're in?
That may well be the case, yeah. I'm very worried about the situation with Brexit and its impact on our society. I think we're now beginning to see the absolute sharp effects of that. So I'm very worried about what that's going to do to our economic performance. And I think the The data will speak for itself in due course. The indicators will speak for themselves in due course. But undoubtedly, when you're facing economic threats of that magnitude, then it will show up in the indicators. Mm-hmm. Now, we'll try our best to withstand that. We always do. We try our level best to try to put in place a performance on all aspects that overcome these difficulties. But I have to be candid with the committee that I have my anxieties about these points.
Mm-hmm. Next question was around, obviously, from the 70 indicators we have in place, only 17 or 24% are actually showing improving. Now, because these are long-term measures, should we be happy with that performance? I know that every government would like to see 100% improvement everywhere, but I guess that wouldn't be realistic. So is 24%, is that, would you say, a good figure?
I think what I'd encourage the committee to do is to look at all of this in the round, because you know some of the performance maintaining that we have is a maintenance of a very high level of performance. So it's not average, it's not pedestrian, it's actually a very high level of performance that is being sustained, and that's no mean feat given the challenges that we face as a society. But I think what I would assure the committee about is that there is a culture within government and within public authorities which, and again, going back to some of the examples that I cited in my discussions with Michelle Thompson, where there is a challenge to existing performance to improve further by a variety of different reports and analysis that comes forward. So there certainly should be a culture across the public sector which is constantly seeking improvement in the way in which we are delivering public services.
Mm-hmm. And one last question, but before that I'd like to refer committee to my register of interest, but I'm still a councillor. It's around linking budget to outcomes. Now, obviously, there is ring-fence funds that go to local government to really prioritise some of the outcomes in the MPF. But I guess there is other outcomes, I'm thinking around culture, economic development, where you know local authorities would probably do the right thing, but they don't feel there's a budgetary benefit to them in the short term. Is that something you think could be addressed going forward? Or?
Well, I think there's I've been around in this area of policy long enough to have frankly seen just about it all. And one of the first things I did as Finance Minister in 2007 was to remove hundreds of ring-fenced funds from local authorities to provide local authorities with much greater scope and flexibility about how they could operate. A lot of that removal of ring fencing remains in place, so local authorities have got a huge amount of scope to act, and they've also got general powers in relation to well-being, which the convener has championed over many years in his parliamentary involvement. So there is that scope for local authorities to act. That will, I suppose, always be a demand for more money from local authorities. I don't suspect that will really ever change. But I think the government does all that it can within the resources available to it to ensure that local authorities have the funding that they can rely upon to support public services at local level. And, of course, Parliament has a budget process where it can shift that balance if it chooses to do so.
Mm-hmm. But I guess any calls from local government for more money really has to be tied to the outcomes based.
Well, I think what I would certainly, what I'm very keen to encourage is the deployment of public expenditure very closely to achieve outcomes. I think that's what we should be doing at all times. And the examples I've cited today, the policy shift to expand early learning and childcare was a quite deliberate financial choice to improve an outcome, which was about the quality of start that children got in their lives. So that's a very good example of, what we do with money to affect an outcome. And the response to the care review is another example of that, where they've pointed out, really quite bluntly, to public authorities, we don't think your current route for expenditure is delivering good outcomes. Here is a different way to do it, and we are accepting that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Ross.
Thanks very much, Convener. I mean, we've covered quite a lot of ground already. I think the point was made, I think it was Daniel Johnson earlier on, that, you know, ministers don't come very often to Parliament and say, talk about the National Performance Framework. But, I mean, it can also be argued that the rest of us in Parliament, backbenchers and opposition, don't actually ask questions about the National Performance Framework very much. I mean, should we all be concerned about that, that it's not got that high profile that the number of nurses, the number of police, the number of ambulances, you know, they're that these kind of numbers we all get very excited about. Do you think we should be doing more to promote the National Performance Framework, or is it not a problem?
I think that there's an inevitability that there will be a much greater focus on some of the shorter term issues about service performance or service configuration. I think that's essential. But I do think in the process we need to have our eyes also on the long term as well as the short term. So greater focus on the National Performance Framework, looking at what are the trends that are taking place. Are we satisfied that we are making enough progress on particular directions? I think we could be doing with strengthening that attention. If you take an issue such as child poverty, my social justice colleague will make statements to Parliament about progress on tackling child poverty, which is a constant and ongoing priority. So that's an example of a long-term focus which is being the subject of an update to Parliament. My colleague responsible for net zero has to make climate change statements to Parliament, which are about how are we progressing towards a long-term policy direction. So I think there's always the scope for more focus on these issues, and the government, of course, would be very happy to participate in that scrutiny.
So, I mean, in one sense, the National Performance Framework is sitting in the background, even if it's not always specifically mentioned.
Correct.
And therefore, the result is a lot of the public don't know what it is or anything.
That's correct. But I think the audience for the National Performance Framework is a lot of the decision-making bodies who, if a decision-making body, a local authority or a public body, takes decisions which are contrary to the direction of travel of what is hoped for in the National Performance Framework, then that's a problem. So the key audience, in my view, is the organisations who will be part of delivering on this journey need to, as statute says, have due regard to what is in the National Performance Framework. So a local authority really paying no attention to the National Performance Framework in its formulation of its policy would be an item of concern to me.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you talked there too about, we're making enough progress, say, on climate change or child poverty or these kind of things. And, I mean, that kind of brings back the question of, should there be time-limited targets in amongst all this? And I think the convener mentioned earlier that, we don't have that so much now because it's more continuous improvement. Although actually around climate change, we do have quite a lot of time targets. Are you happy that, that switch from maybe more time targets to more continuous improvement, has that been the right one, or do we need to reshift?
I think we've always got to be mindful of the balance there, because the time-limited targets can provide greater focus and impetus to the making of progress. We just have to be absolutely certain that we're putting them in the right areas to make the greatest amount of progress that we can. So we've got time limited targets on climate change and child poverty, which are pretty fundamental issues in our society today. So a lot of activity will be focused around ensuring that we can be in a position to achieve those measurable targets.
Mm-hmm. I mean, COVID's been mentioned as well, and in fact, that's made it more difficult to get the data. I take all of that kind of point that's already been said. I mean, going forward, if something worsens, and my guess is that quite a few measurements will worsen because of COVID, is it going to be possible to clearly split out how much of that is COVID and how much of that is other reasons? In fact, something might be improving for other reasons, but COVID kind of has dragged it down.
I think the important point in looking at, and much of the data analysis is configured around this point, is about looking at trends rather than moments in time. And I think that the point that Mr. Mason puts to me is best addressed by looking at the experience over time, because that will highlight whether there was any underlying sustained period of improvement that may have been worsened because of COVID, about which we might be optimistic about making a return to improve performance. But it will be best detected by looking at the trend performance and data.
Okay, thanks, Convener.
Douglas, you want to come in with a supplementary there?
Yes, I did. Thank you, Convener. It was just around, I'm just thinking in my head, about the local outcome improvement plans and how do they map to the performance framework, and is there a check done to ensure that they are aligned?
I suppose that gets us into some of the issues about local discretion and decision making, because there certainly isn't a check, because that would be a level of interference by central government in the legitimate scope for decision making by local authorities and community planning partnerships that would be inappropriate. There will be dialogue, undoubtedly, but a check would be an exaggeration of, I think it would be inappropriate given our current statutory framework. The way that statute is constructed, public authorities have a duty to have regard to, and that, as Mr. Lumsden will be familiar from his local authority background, that is something that a local authority must properly and fully consider and reflect that. So there isn't, I couldn't say that there's a 32-piece jigsaw puzzle that adds up to making a neat picture about each of these indicators about what's going to happen in each local authority area or each community planning partnership area, but there is an expectation that those partnerships will have due regard to and follow that direction. And I have to say that the leadership of the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, and in particular its president, towards supporting this direction of policy has been appreciated by government and is very resolute in how that's taken forward.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Just a process question to begin with, Cabinet Secretary, around the two upcoming processes that will affect the performance framework, one being the review of the national outcomes. But the government's also confirmed that the Wellbeing and Sustainable Development Bill will have some effect on the NPF. Could you explain how those two processes are going to interact? Will it be sequential? Will development of the bill only take place after the review of national outcomes, or will the processes overlap and interact?
I think there's a likelihood they will overlap, I would think, but we'll obviously have to make sure there's a clear line of sight between the two. But I think the preparatory work on the Wellbeing Bill is likely to take place. I better just give myself the caveat that I better just confirm this in writing to the committee, but I think the timescale of preparation of that bill undoubtedly will be undertaken at the same time as the review of the national outcomes.
So how do we prevent those processes becoming siloed, given that they both feed into what is the same framework?
Essentially, you know, we will be internally within government, and I'm very happy for us to be open and to have open dialogue with Parliament and its committees, in particular this committee, on ensuring that those processes are very closely linked together. Essentially, many of the discussions I've had internally about the wellbeing legislation, it's involving ministers and officials who are also involved in the National Performance Framework. So these are not compartmentalised conversations. But I'm very happy to give the committee an assurance that we will have open dialogue around those questions.
Thank you. I'm sure that's an issue we'll want to revisit. Next question, it goes back somewhat to Michelle Thompson's initial line of questioning around the top-line measurements of improving, maintaining, worsening. And I accept completely that is the top line of what is a very detailed process, and at every level beneath that you get much more granular data. But even for a top line, I'm concerned that it might be just a touch too simplified. So to take as an example the active travel measurement. So that's classified as improving, but it is very, very far off hitting the targets the Scottish Government has set in active travel. You know, cycling, for example, we got to 4% of journeys by cycling when the 2020 target was 10%. Is that the improving measurement in particular, the improving classification in this measurement, is there a danger that this is simplifying some of these measurements just slightly too much, in that a whole range of them could be improving, but essentially glacially, and not actually on a trajectory towards the targets that have been set?
It's an entirely fair challenge, if a minister's only interaction about the performance of a policy area is to look at this chart and say, "Oh, that's improving. I don't need to worry about that," then I think I wouldn't advise that. I think you have to go beneath and look at the patterns and the trends. And the assurance I would give to Mr. Greer is that when ministers are being briefed about detail and performance, the underlying patterns, this relates to my response to John Mason a moment ago and a number of the other answers that I've given this morning, the underlying pattern and performance is highlighted, challenged, explored, compared against what might be reasonably expected, so that there's a proper understanding of whether this is a reasonable conclusion to arrive at or not.
Thank you for that answer. I've no doubt that ministers are going into this in far greater level of detail than just that top line measurement. But to go back to John Mason's line of questioning, if we're trying to get wider public buy-in, but also wider buy-in from across the various levels of the state and of the third sector, I suppose, for this, is there not a question about whether or not this measurement is a useful presentation for those who are only engaging at surface level?
I think yes, is the short answer. I think there's this is one attempt to try to look at what is an assessment of performance. If one was to look at that in a rather glib way, I could see how you could arrive at the challenge that Mr. Greer is posing to me. What the alternatives are, I remember back to 2007, I think we had a variety of coloured arrows which were designed to try to help, but I think they probably fell victim to exactly the same challenge that Mr. Greer is putting to me. So I think the key point is that there will be a whole range of different actions have to be taken to try to improve performance in a particular area. And if we were to say, journeys by active travel, performance improving, that should determine our steps on active travel, then I think that would be the wrong conclusion to arrive at. You've got to take a whole range of other interventions to improve that performance.
Thanks. Final question from myself is around the role of transport in the NPF. So there's one obvious transport indicator, which is the active travel one we've just mentioned. It's tangentially related to a couple of others around greenhouse gas emissions, public satisfaction with public services, public transport's mentioned there. But transport seems to be the one major area of government responsibility that's not directly addressed. So health, education, environment, economy, etc., are all categories under which groups of outcomes are measured. Transport isn't one of those categories. It's got that one specific indicator around active travel, but everywhere else it's just tangentially related to an indicator. Given the importance of transport for our net zero ambitions in particular, and the challenges that we've had with reducing transport emissions compared to all other sectors, Do you have any concern that the NPF is perhaps not taking transport into account to the extent that we need it to hit those wider outcomes?
I think that's a fair observation, that there perhaps is not the profile and the focus that there should be. I think the description of the transport indicators as part of influencing a range of other factors is a fair assessment. I think going back to what I said in my response to Tess White, you could take a decision. The review in 2023 might come to this conclusion that this needs to be an awful lot more, if I can speak colloquially, a lot more net zero than it is just now. That might be a reasonable conclusion to come to out of that review, and therefore the transport indicators, given their significance, may well reflect that change in emphasis. But what I would assure Mr. Greer about is that there will be a number of areas where the impact and the effect of transport within the performance of different areas of policy are reflected, but there can obviously be ways in which we can revise and revisit that material.
Thank you. That's all from me, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, Cabinet Secretary, you've already responded to more than 30 questions from the committee, well done, but we're still within time, so I'm just going to ask some more short questions just to finish off. So, Audit Scotland, it said that there are inherent challenges in delivering an outcome-based approach. For example, it's difficult to separate out what impact public services have on outcomes, as many factors are outside the direct control of the public sector. And they talk about how that can be resolved through effective joint-up working, early planning, and an understanding of the evidence and its gaps all help. Now, I'm just wondering, though, these gaps, I'm just wondering how they can be closed so that we have a much fairer picture.
I think the observations from Audit Scotland, I think, are reasonable observations. I think in all of my evidence this morning, I certainly hope the committee has got the sense from me that I think it's important that we look at a lot of this information in the round, so that we don't just, we don't just make glib judgments about individual components. I think the challenge that the Audit Scotland comments highlight is that it is difficult to make a direct connection about every single pound of public expenditure and every outcome that's achieved. It's more obvious in some areas than in others, but it can be difficult to make that link. However, the comments that the Auditor General made a couple of weeks ago in relation to the way in which we need to operate to ensure that we improve outcomes, which are all heavily based on collaboration, on partnership working, on disrespecting organisational boundaries, on focusing more on outcomes than on inputs, I think helps to structure the discussion that we can legitimately have to consider whether or not public expenditure is being used as effectively as it could be used to achieve outcomes that are widely shared within our society. And I think the National Performance Framework helps us in that respect.
Okay, thank you. And in response to Tess White, you talked about audit, statutory reporting and parliamentary scrutiny all playing a role, as well as the National Performance Framework. So amid this landscape, where does the NPF fit in terms of assessing success of government policy? So, for example, is it kind of weighted relative to these other areas, or how does the government decide?
What we have tried to do, and we arrived at this position after extensive stakeholder dialogue and parliamentary engagement, was to create a framework which gave as clear a sense of direction to the public as we possibly could, the public and to public bodies, of the direction the government is trying to take the country, and of what the purpose of our policy interventions are, what values underpin those, and what outcomes we are trying to achieve as a distillation of that journey. And beneath that picture, so that picture is designed to enable a range of different organisations to decide what they may do, where they may spend their resources to contribute towards that direction of travel. Now, that is a what I would describe as an approach designed to influence, not direct, the choices that are made in terms of priorities and policy making at a local level. It's designed to influence, not to direct. And I think that's the right approach given our current statutory arrangements as a country. What there is then, so organisations can then look to identify what they can contribute to this process, and then there is a whole series of measures and mechanisms of accountability that provide us with assurance about how much progress has been made on that journey. And all of those measures of accountability are publicly available. Some of them are published in relation to NPF, others are published more widely, others are the subject of analysis by organisations such as Audit Scotland.
Okay, but how do you weigh specifically the NPF relative to these other areas? I mean, how do you say that we've looked at these indicators and they're worsening or indeed improving or maintaining, whatever it happens to be, and you then decide additional resource may or may not have to be shifted from A to B in order to address those matters?
That's a process of reflection that goes on within Cabinet, where we look at the issues that are being identified by the National Performance Framework in relation to our policy agenda, and where we look to take different decisions to improve performance. So part of my responsibility as Deputy First Minister is around the delivery of the government's agenda. So I am looking, I've been looking over the course of the period since the election, at the delivery of our commitments that were made around the 100 Days programme. I'm now focusing my attention on the delivery of the programme for government and the partnership agreement to ensure that we have in place the arrangements that will give us confidence that that programme will be able to be delivered and that it will help us to achieve the ambitions that are set out in the National Performance Framework.
Thank you. And finally, from me, the National Performance Framework's now been in existence for some 14 years. When it came out, it was considered to be world leading. I'm just wondering, do you believe that Scotland is a better place because of the National Performance Framework? And if so, how can you evaluate that?
I think we're in a better place because we have a much greater focus on the achievement of outcomes in Scotland today than was the case in 2007. I think that's been that to me has been the substantive policy development over those years, that we have a much greater focus on the achievement of outcomes. And that, I think, is a prize worth having, because I think government in general can be bedevilled by focusing on the short-term, immediate, high-profile issues at the expense of taking the necessary steps on the long-term outcome-based journeys. And now, that doesn't mean that everything is sort of smooth and lateral, that it all just takes a lovely, neat course. The road is very bumpy. But I think having that focus on the long-term policy direction and the outcomes to be achieved is a significant strength for Scotland today.
Thank you. We shall end on that positive note. And I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials today for coming along, and particularly the Deputy First Minister for his expansive contributions and responses to questions. I would also like to add that I'm particularly pleased that you've been here in person. We've found that it greatly improves our interaction with witnesses when people are in the room today, and certainly you've helped improve greatly our understanding of the workings of the National Performance Framework. So without further ado, I would like to thank our witnesses. I'm going to call a 2-minute recess, and then we'll come back just for a few minutes for one or two wee housekeeping issues. But thank you very much, Deputy First Minister. We'll actually close the public part of the meeting at this point.